بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين جل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وجعلنا من أعوانه وأنصاره Alhamdulillah, we have this opportunity to talk about some of the important ideas in Islam that normally are neglected. And indeed, as inshallah we will see, the greatest strength and beauty of Islam can be understood when we look at Islam from this perspective. Salaam alaikum. Therefore, inshallah, with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what we are going to do is to mention some of the important teachings of Islam about society, about community life, and the way that Islamic spirituality must be reflected in a community so that that community can be considered as a Muslim community. And then, inshallah, we will talk about the true understanding of wilaya, which is very important concept for us followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, and we will see that how it has a collective nature, a social nature. And then inshallah we will have a group discussion. We will be divided into smaller groups, and each group will try to come up with some proposals regarding how can we, inshallah, establish this kind of idea and understanding about community. Okay, so I start, and I hope, inshallah, if you have any question, any comment, you make note of it. So every about 40 minutes, you know, I stop. Maybe I will have talks for 40 minutes, but after each 40 minutes I talk, stop. You can have a refreshment and also question and answer, then we continue. If I make things very brief, at least I need 2 hours, but we see how it goes. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. First of all, I want to start with a kind of a story, a kind of personal memory, which is very important for all of us to know. Many years ago, I think it was the year 2000, I was busy with writing a book on Shia Islam. I don't know if you have seen the book Shia Islam, Origins, Faith and Practices. I was writing that book for Islamic College in London, and that was based on 2 series of lectures that I had. One was in Qom before I moved to the UK, and one was in Manchester when I was doing my PhD. So I was putting my notes together to come up with a book that can be used for introducing Shia Islam. Then I wanted to write a chapter about characteristics of Shia Islam. I am sure many times you are asked, what is the difference between Sunni Islam and Shia Islam? There are different ways to answer this. Some people say, for example, you know, we believe in Imamah, and they don't believe, for example, in Imam. Or if they want to be more precise, that they say we believe in imamah as a kind of divinely appointed position. They believe in imamah as a kind of leadership which can be decided by people. Because in a very, you know, technical way, even Sunnis believe in imamah. The only group that doesn't believe in imamah is Khawarij. Khawarij didn't believe in imamah. Otherwise, everyone believes in imamah, but it's a matter of whether imam has to be appointed or not, and whether imam has to be infallible or not. Otherwise, the Sunnis say imam is there, and he has ra'asatun amma fi umur ad-din wa ad-dunya, has inclusive leadership power with respect to the secular affairs and religious affairs. Anyway, so this is one way of saying that what is the difference between Shia Muslim and Sunni Muslim. Or some people may go further and they say, you know, for example, we say our prayer in this way, they say their prayer in that way. We make wuzu in this way, they... Okay, these are the things that you can say, and they are correct. I'm not saying they are wrong. But I was looking for something more meaningful. Then, alhamdulillah, I came up with this idea. And since then, it's now about 12 years, day by day, I become more convinced that these three are the most important things. So I wrote a chapter on that. And then I gave a series of 12 lectures in London on that, and then 12 lectures in Toronto. If you want, it's available online, Characteristics of Shia Islam. I said, in my understanding, Shia Islam, which is true understanding of Islam, has three things that if you put them together, not just one of them or two of them, if you have these three together, then you reach the core of the Shia Islam. If you don't have these three, even lack one of them, you are not a true Shia. And you have not reached to the core of Shia Islam. What are those three? You shouldn't expect from me to tell you some doctrines, because doctrines are just, for example, for beliefs. I am saying three things that are present in every corner, in our doctrine, in our faith, in our akhlaq, in our politics, in everything. These three must be there. One is rationality. For us to be rational is very important. For us, aql, intellect or reason, is a hujjah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna lillahi ta'ala ala nas hujjatayn. Allah has two ways of communicating His will to us. Because hujjah, if someone asks you what is the meaning of hujjah, what do you say? What is hujjah?
Proof.
Yeah, proof. But what does proof mean? Proof is not very, you know, accurate. You know, when we say Quran is hujjah, Sunnah of the Prophet is hujjah, Aql is hujjah, what does it mean?
Undisputed evidence, maybe. Yeah.
The best thing that I have found is what we have in Salam Al Yasin, Ziyarat Al Yasin. We say, As-salamu alayka ya hujjatallah wa dalila iradatihi. Hujjah of Allah is dalilu iradatihi. It means that it's an evidence by which you can understand will of God. This is the meaning of hujjah. Hujjah is either a person or something like Quran or Sunnah, that if you refer to that, you can understand what Allah wants from you. Okay? Therefore, on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us whether we have acted according to the hujjah or not. We also can answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to the hujjah. So if Allah asks me, How did you say your prayer? How did you, I don't know, go to Hajj? How did you fast? How did you believe? Then I can say, I had this from your Hujjah. Okay? But if I don't have Hujjah, I have done it, you know, according to my own, you know, speculation, then I would be not able to have answer. So, we have two types of Hujjah. Hujjatan Zahira, the outward or external Hujjah, which is Al-Anbiya wa Rusul. These are the prophets, messengers that Allah has sent. وَحُجَّةً بَاطِنَةً. And we have an internal, something inward. And that is Al-Aql. For us, Aql is very important. Even in our understanding of Islamic Sharia, legal issues, you are more text-based. But in theology, you can be very much, you know, intellectual, rational. But for us, even in Sharia, which is very much to be text-based, still Aql is one of our main sources. If you understand something through decisive, rational process, you can be sure that this is the will of God. كُلَّمَا حَكَمَ بِهِ الْعَقْلِ حَكَمَ بِهِ الشَّرْعِ وَكُلَّمَا حَكَمَ بِهِ الشَّرْعِ حَكَمَ بِهِ الْعَقْلِ. Every judgment which is made by Aql is accepted by Shar. Every judgment which is made by Shar is accepted by Aql. No school of Islam and no religion I have seen so far that they can sit so relaxed and talk about the harmony between reason and revelation. And we have had, you know, many rounds of dialogue on this, and the second book of Catholic Shia dialogue is on reason, faith in theory and practice, and we address this issue. For us, Aql is a hujjah. Aql is not a threat. Aql is not something that we have to be worried about. Aql is something that functions in a proper way all the time in all people. Even kuffar, if they use their Aql properly, they come to good conclusion. It's not that their Aql is corrupt. It's not that Aql betrays. Aql is a hujjah of Allah. Is it possible that a prophet betrays? A prophet becomes corrupt? No. Aql also never becomes corrupt. The problem is that people don't follow Aql. Therefore, the Quran says those who end up with being in hell, they say, لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعْقِلْ مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعْرِ. If we had listened, which means listen to the prophets, revelation, or if we had thought, used our Aql, we were not in this painful situation. So a kafir does not say, I wish I didn't use my Aql because my Aql was corrupt. No, kafir says, I wish I had used my Aql because Aql is a hujjah of Allah that Allah gave me, I didn't pay attention. There are so many verses in the Quran that Allah says, why they don't think? Why they don't reflect? So, for us followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, to be religious means to be rational. If you look at the history of Islam, you see that Shia, right from the beginning, were very interested in intellectual sciences, in kalam, in philosophy, in logic. But there were many non-Shia who, first of all, they opposed kalam. They said kalam is bid'ah. When Kalam was established, then they accepted Kalam, they said philosophy is bid'ah. And even still today, some of them don't accept philosophy. If you go to some of the Muslim countries from the, you know, north to the south, you don't find a single department of philosophy. I don't want to mention names. In the whole country, there is no department of philosophy. If you go to Iran, even in a small towns, if there is a university, they have normally department of philosophy. Maybe there are, I don't know, more than 100 departments of philosophy. Some people who are scholars of, you know, biographies, you know, tarajim, they write tarajim. Sometimes they come across some cases that it's not clear whether that person was a Shia or not. Yeah? It's not that every person is clearly known, because there were circumstances that they couldn't expressly say things. One of the things that they use as an evidence to say that this person is more likely to be Shia is whether that person had an interest in philosophy or not. If someone had an interest in philosophy, they say he's more likely to be a Shia. Sometimes, you know, you have salam alaikum discussion with some of, you know, people who are very much, unfortunately, against the Shia, and you see how afraid they are of philosophy. When you want to speak with them in a rational way, they say, no, this is philosophy, as if, you know, it's a taboo, you know, it's philosophy is, you know, something from shaitan. They are even worried to mention the name of philosophy. In any case, for us, rationality is very important. If you are interested, if you go to the first section of Al-Kafi, Kitabul Aql wal Jahl, the very first part of Kafi, Kitabul Aql wal Jahl, just read the hadith about significance of Aql. In particular, read the hadith from Imam Kazim alayhi salam, in which Imam told Hisham ibn Hakam about the significance of Aql. Alhamdulillah, we started some lectures on this topic in English. If you go to shia.com, you will see those lectures. Maybe so far we have had 4 lectures on this in Haram, in Qom, and they are available online. A very beautiful hadith about the significance of Aql. Very beautiful. So for us, rationality is very important. The second thing is spirituality. In the school of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, we are not just after performance of certain rituals. You know, many, unfortunately, people, whether Muslims or non-Muslims, they have ritualistic understanding of religion. They, for example, pray, they fast, they recite Quran, but you don't feel any kind of connection. You know, for us, Ahlul Bayt, alhamdulillah, have taught us that you should be concentrating on the spirit and not just the, you know, surface of worship. For example, if you want to make sure that inshallah your salat is accepted, you have to have presence of heart. Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam says that only that part of salat in which you have presence of heart is accepted. You know, we have two concepts. One is validity of salat, one is acceptability of salat. Maybe you observe all the legal requirements, so your salat is valid, but it's not necessarily accepted. And salat is something that acceptance of other actions also depend on salat. In qubilat, qubila ma sawaha, wa in ruddat, we have many hadiths about etiquettes of praying, not just fiqhi and legal rulings, about spiritual aspect of salat. Many of our ulama have written books on adabus salat, asrarus salat. Why? Because we, followers of Ahlul Bayt, want to make sure that we just don't, you know, bend and, you know, stand up and say few things. We want to have the spirit of Salat. Okay? Dua. In which school of Islam you have so much, you know, literature and beautiful, you know, pieces and masterpieces of dua. You know, without any, you know, biasness. Inshallah, I am not biased. You know, everyone who knows that other schools of Islam have more, you know, please ask them to bring. Who has something like Sahifi Sajjali? Any school of Islam, if they have something like Sahifi, let them bring. Munajat Sha'baniyya, Dua Iftitah, Dua Abu Hamza, Dua Arafah. Why? Because we are interested in these things. Dua Kumail, you know, normally in every Shia center, you know, they have Dua Kumail. In many places, they have Dua Nutbe. I hope, inshallah, Dearborn, you have Dua Nutbe. This is very important. Why? Because to pray, to supplicate, is the core. Ad-du'a mukhul ibadah. If you just pray, but you don't have this habit of supplicating to Allah and whispering to Allah, it's not enough. And therefore you see that even Sufi orders, which are not Shia, because some of them are Shia, but even those orders which are not Shia, when they trace back their genealogy, they reach Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. More than 90% of them, if not 99, they reach our Imams. There are only maybe very few, maybe one, two, that because of sometimes, you know, some conflicts, they wanted to find other, you know, source. So, for example, they wanted to go to the first caliph, you know, something like this. Otherwise, they go back to our Imams. They are Sunni, but they know that if they want a spirituality of the Prophet, they have to go to Imam Reza, for example. They have to go to Imam Zain al-Abidin, and finally to Imam Ali. There are many Sunni scholars who believe that the knowledge and spirituality of Prophet was available in Imam Ali, although they don't believe that he was to be Imam or the first Caliph. They say, no, the first Caliph was okay. But Velaya was for Ali. Knowledge was for Ali. So, spirituality is the second aspect of Shia Islam. And the third, search for justice. Right from the beginning, the followers of Ahlul Bayt were concerned about justice. Starting with understanding of divine justice, because that is the essence, that is the root. You know, for many Muslims, divine justice is not really a, you know, meaningful concept. I don't know if you are familiar with the debate which was between Ash'arites and Mu'tazilites and the Shiites, you know. Ash'arites, which today are the majority of Sunni world when it comes to Kalam, these people had the idea that God is just because whatever He does is justice. By definition, you know. If you listen, you know, carefully. If God, for example, sends a pious person to hell, they say this is justice. Why? Because justice is not something objective. Justice is not something independently understandable. Whatever God does is just. Whatever God does is good. There is no intrinsic value in actions. Therefore, if there was no religion, everything was equal. But Mu'tazilites and the Shiites, who were called Adliya, the people of justice, they had a different understanding. They say, no, whether you believe in religion or not, whether you believe in God or not, there are objective values. To, for example, do injustice to an orphan, to take money of an orphan without legitimate reason, to, I don't know, kill an innocent person, to break your promise. These are the things that you understand they are bad, whether you have religion or not. It's not that God has arbitrarily, na'uzu billah, said, inna Allah ya'murukum bil adl wal ihsan. He could have said, inna Allah ya'murukum bil zulm. But now he says, inna Allah ya'mur. No, it's not arbitrary. We accept that whatever God does is good, but because He does the things which are good, not that He does things and then we say, okay, this is good. You understand? You know, there are people who are very good in shooting, you know, arrows. So if, for example, there is a target, so they can shoot and they hit the middle. There are people who are not good, but they think they are clever. What they do is that they first shoot the arrow and then they make a circle around that and say, this is it, I hit the target. According to the Ash'arites, God, na'uzu billah, is like this. He does things and then He says, these are good things. Everything that He wishes He can do, and then He says, this is justice. We say, no. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَانِ, it means that human beings can have understanding of adl. Even the basic things can be understood without religion. And religion comes and confirms that and expands. Therefore you see that Imam Hussein alayhi salam, on the day of Ashura, when he saw that enemies are moving towards the tents, he said, "Ellam yakun lakum din, wa kuntum la takhafun al-ma'ad, fakunu ahraran fi dunyakum." If you don't believe in any religion and you don't have fear of akhirah, at least be noble. You don't need to be a Muslim or Christian so that you know that you should not attack children. If there was no religion at all, if there was no prophet at all, we as human beings understand that this is bad. In any way, this debate over justice started first with understanding the true meaning of divine justice, and therefore Shia made it a principle of their madhab and denomination, but then it went on to social justice. Right from the beginning, Shia were asking for establishment of justice. And this is interesting. None of our imams died naturally. If they were not asking for justice, if they didn't have, you know, something, a cause that they were working for it, why enemies were afraid? In Ziyarat Arba'in, we say to Imam Hussein alayhi salam, that you are al-madhulum al-shaheed. What does madhulum al-shaheed mean? It means that you are a person who opposed the unjust people to the point that he gave his life. If he was silenced, if he was not doing anything against the unjust system, if he was, you know, compromising with them, okay, they were not in need of killing him. There were many revolutions, Qiyam al-Tawwabin, Qiyam al-Mukhtar, Qiyam al-Fakh, even many small, you know, states of the followers of Ahlul Bayt were formed in northern Iran, in many places, because they were not accepting the ruling of the unjust caliphs. the unjust caliphs were not accepted. You know, in Sunni Islam, you know, it's not a matter of sectarian, it's not, these are academic, you know, discussions. Up to recent, the majority, great majority, had the idea that you can never protest against a ruler. Whether he has come to the power by, for example, election or I don't know, a legitimate way, or he has killed the previous Khalifa, has become, you know, now Khalifa. As long as he has power, he is Waliyul Amr, and you cannot do anything. This was their mentality. It's very recent that now they, you know, oppose and, you know, they have, you know, these kind of protests and revolutions and this kind of thing. The majority, great majority, had the idea that you can never say anything, whether he is Muawiyah or Yazid or Abdul Malik ibn Marwan or Harun al-Rashid, because he has power, he is Khalifatul Rasul, Waliyul Amr, and you must accept that. If you don't accept, if you rebel against him, then you are Tali, you are Baghi. This is the understanding, but Shia say no. Very first requirement of being a ruler is to be just. And not only that, the Shia said that even if you want to be Friday prayer leader, you have to be just. Forget Khalifa. Even if you want to be Imam of a small mosque that 5-6 people, you know, say their prayer behind you, you have to be just. If you want to bear witness on a small case, you have to be just. For us, justice is very important. If you look at the positions that we have, you see that every position which has social nature needs justice. To be a judge, you have to be just. To be a marja, you have to be just. Always we focus on justice, justice, adala. And adala is a very comprehensive concept for us. Because in many societies, when you say justice, especially in modern, you know, English, when you say justice, they only have a kind of legalistic understanding. They think that justice is to punish the criminals. You know, when you say justice, it means righteousness. It means that even with respect to yourself, you have to be just. You know, you can live in a cave alone and be unjust. So it's not always interpersonal. It can be inside a person. If I don't look after my piety, I am unjust to myself. So this is a very comprehensive concept. So for the school of Ahlul Bayt, spirituality, rationality, and search for justice are three important things that are present in every corner. In akhlaq, in fiqh, in politics, in everything, in aqidah. You have Muslims who are rational, but maybe not spiritual. Or maybe they are spiritual, but they don't bother about justice. Or they bother about justice, but they do things which are not rational. Or they become brutal. A follower of Ahlul Bayt must have these three together. And it's such a, you know, beautiful combination. I think if you have these three together, you cannot go to any wrong direction. If you have spirituality, so you want everything for the sake of God, your heart is pure, there is no ego, there is no selfishness, and at the same time you want justice, but in a rational way, you don't do stupid things, then you will be successful. And everyone loves such people. I don't think you find anyone in the world who says that I hate a person who is rational, spiritual, and has concern for justice. After some years, when, you know, this was about maybe year 2000 that I was writing this chapter. Then we had a group of visitors from UK, you know, some Catholic friends. I invited them to come to Qom. And I went to airport to welcome them. So airport is in Tehran, so I went to Tehran. And it was late night or middle of night that we were going back to Qom. One of them, who is a lecturer in the University of London, he asked me what is the difference between Shia Islam and Sunni Islam. You know, for the first time he's coming to Iran and going to Qom, so he wants to know this. So I told him this point. I said, Shia believe in three things together: spirituality, rationality, search for justice. Now, after many years, normally every time we meet, he says, still I am thinking about those three. And in November 2010, I saw him in US, in Atlanta, you know, there was American Academy of Religion. I saw him there. And he said, I am writing a book and one chapter is about these three. And so I'm referring to what you said to me. So even for a Christian, this combination is very meaningful. A spirituality, rationality, search for justice. Okay, now if we have these three together, I want to explain what type of understanding of spirituality will develop. Of course, we can have something like this. For example, if we have these three together, what type of rationality will develop? What type of search for justice will develop? But this is not what we are going to discuss today. We want to see what type of spirituality will develop. Because there are many people who are interested in spirituality, but sometimes you see there is no depth. There is no really intellectual, you know, understanding. There is no concern for justice. They spend all their, you know, life, for example, you know, in a very isolated, for example, place. They don't bother about what is happening to the world. The late Ayatollah Mutahhari says that one of these, you know, Sufis, one of these, you know, Zuhad, because Sufi was not first used. It was started being used in the 3rd century as a term. Before that, they were talking about Zuhad. When he heard that Imam Hussein alayhi salam was killed, he said they did very bad thing to Hussein. This was the maximum, you know, he did. He didn't go to defend justice. And then Ayatollah Mutahhari, later he regretted. He said this was a word for dunya. I shouldn't have talked about worldly issue. Hussein is killed, this is a worldly issue. You know, you have sometimes people that they think that everything other than dua and, you know, salat is worldly. Justice, you shouldn't bother because it's worldly. This is wrong. In Islamic spirituality, we have to pay attention to both worldly and religious affairs. Indeed, we don't have such a separation. For us, everything is religious. Because our religion is penetrating to every corner of life. You cannot, you know, make a border and say, this is religion, this is your personal life. Or this is, you know, religion and this is public life. Islam is a religion which directs us and guides us in every corner of our life. So, what I want to share with you very quickly, I don't have time to expand on these points, I move on to the next section, is about some of the things which must be available in a Muslim community so that they can say that we have established, we have exemplified, we have illustrated Islamic spirituality in our community. Okay? It's not something that can be sorted out by name. We say, this is Islamic community. Why? Because it is written on the board. this is Muslim school, this is Muslim community, this is Islamic, for example, I don't know, mosque or association, whatever. It's not a matter of name. If name was enough, then life was very easy. I put the name of my son philosopher, then he's a philosopher. I put his name engineer, then he becomes engineer. It's not like this. If we put the name of our association, you know, Muslim association or Muslim center, it doesn't become necessarily Muslim association. Even if all the people who are there are Muslims, still it may not be Muslim association, may not be Muslim center, Muslim school. This is one big problem that we have in our mind. We think that when Muslims come together, then automatically that corporation or that society becomes Muslim society. No. You can have a school in which all the teachers, all the staff, all the students are Muslim, but that is not Islamic school. Even you can have a mosque that imam and those who go for prayer, all are Muslims, but it is not Islamic mosque. When we don't observe norms of Islam, if for example, a Muslim who doesn't speak our language comes there and doesn't feel at home, this is not mosque. You have called it mosque, but it's not mosque. Mosque is a place that belongs to Allah, so every Muslim must feel at home. If only those who are speaking my language or, you know, wearing the same dress as we wear, you know, feel comfortable, this is not mosque. So, what we need to understand is that after being Muslim, what extra we have to take on board so that we make our social entities Islamic. How can we have Islamic school, Islamic mosque, Islamic society, Islamic community? This is it. Islamic party, Islamic organization. This is something that is not, unfortunately, normally receiving enough attention. And as I said at the beginning, indeed, the most beautiful aspect of Islam is the ability of Islam to make a society that people love, not just individuals. You know, imagine if you have all the parts for example, a very good car, okay? All the parts are excellent. All are, you know, coming from the same factory. But if these parts are not assembled, the car is useless. It's all the parts, for example, I don't know, Chrysler, or I don't know, for Mercedes, whatever, but they are not assembled. It's useless. It doesn't function. When do you understand the beauty? When these are assembled. We don't see most of the beauty of Islam because we are not assembled as a community. We come together, but only physically. It's like just putting parts next to each other. Even if you put them so close that there is no space between them, still this doesn't mean that they are assembled. If you put all the bricks and plaster and glass and pipe line, everything together, it doesn't become a house. A house has its own spirit, it has its own structure, its own design. It's more than just having good parts and ingredients. You ladies know about, for example, making a food. If I put all the good ingredients, it doesn't become a delicious, you know, food. They have to be cooked, they have to be, you know, able to melt, they have to mix. It's very important. So when we talk about a Muslim community, we need much more than just having some Muslims who come together. Muslim community is like making a delicious food. And the greatest difficulty starts after you have all the ingredients. We think that when we have ingredients, it's finished. if you have the best ingredients, still the taste is not the taste of that food. If I have meat here and salt here and I don't know a spice, it's not cholo kebab. It's not curry. When we put them together and mix them and melt them and spend time and they are really interacting with each other, this makes it a little salty, that makes it a little sour, that makes it a little hot, you know, all these tastes are all mixed, then we will have one dish. Muslim community is a very beautiful, attractive reality that unfortunately so far I don't think has ever happened in a complete way. Many people think that, especially our Sunni brothers, when they look at Medina in the time of the Prophet, they think that that was ideal society. Everyone was angel. Everyone was perfect. Therefore they say all the companions of the Prophet are Hujjah. Why? Because everyone in Medina was angel, was innocent, was ma'soom. And they quote this hadith that the said Prophet said, "Ashabi kan nujum, bi-ayyihim ihtadaytum, ihtadaytum." My companions are stars. Whoever you follow, you are guided. We have many serious, you know, questions here. First of all, who is a companion of the Prophet? What is your definition? They say whoever met the Prophet while he was a Muslim is a companion. Maybe he met the Prophet once. He's a companion. Second, is it enough just to meet the Prophet and you are a Muslim? So who are those munafiqeen in Medina? Quran talks very much about munafiqeen. Why you don't take them into account? Quran says that there are people in Medina that they do all the mischief against the Prophet. Even they wanted to assassinate the Prophet. They build a mosque in Medina to divide Muslims and to be a place for recruiting enemies. So therefore, you see that normally they don't take these things seriously. They say it was a perfect society. Medina to Nabi is a perfect society. Everyone is innocent. No. Even the society at that time was not satisfactory to the Prophet. The Prophet suffered a lot inside Medina. Yes, there were very good people also in Medina. We don't say that they were not. No, there were very good people. Allah says, Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa alladheena ma'ah ashaddaa 'ala al-kuffar ruhamaa baynahum tarahum ruk'an sujadan. Yes, there were such people there, but not that everyone was perfect. And not that Islam was really established in that society to the bottom of the society. Therefore you see that when the Prophet passed away, unfortunately, soon everything went back. As long as the Prophet was there and was, you know, pumping mercy and love and wisdom, okay, this society was, you know, okay, or looking okay. But still, Islam was not established in every aspect of the social life. In the time of Imam Ali, although Imam Ali was the Imam and the leader and the Caliph, but you cannot say Islamic State was a really Islamic State. Even the Kufa was not a real Islamic society. People in Kufa were not listening to Imam Ali alayhi salam. And even when there were, you know, some, for example, times, you know, Islamic establishments or governments or I don't know parties, I don't think there has ever been a very complete and perfect example of Islamic society. But this doesn't mean that this cannot happen. This is going to happen inshallah in the time of Imam Zaman Ajjalallah Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif. And that is the time that it will be established in a universal way. But before that is established, we have to establish in a small scales. Otherwise, that is not going to be established. If we don't start establishing that type of society, which is based on the norms that I am going to mention, in our own local community, Imam Mahdi will never be able to come. And inshallah, I will give you all the reasons and arguments for that. You cannot say, okay, we sit here, and inshallah, Imam comes, and then we will have a perfect Islamic community. No. This is like what Bani Israel told Musa, اذهب أنت وربك فقاتلا إنها هنا قاعدون. You and your Lord go and fight, we are waiting. We sit here, when it's finished, you know, tell us, we come and enjoy. Many people are waiting for Imam Zaman to come and give them, you know, free packages of holidays, you know, go and enjoy yourself. This is not going to happen. We have to be ready to establish what Imam wants to establish in a universal way. We should start in our local community, and then inshallah, these local communities, when they come together, then Imam will come and take it further, as inshallah we will explain. I don't know if you want to have a short break to have a kind of coffee, tea, and inshallah we can continue. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah al-Ali al-Azim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi al-tayyibin al-tahirin. When we look at the Quran, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very much emphasizes on social life. You know, the way Allah talks to us and addresses us, sometimes Allah says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina aman, O those who believe. Okay? Even when he says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, he talks in a plural form. He doesn't say, Ya ayyuhal ladhi amana, O mu'min. He says, O mu'minun, O those who believe. You know, Allah addresses us in plurality. Sometimes Allah addresses human beings in general. For example, he says, Ya ayyuhal insan, O man, O human being. And sometimes he says, Ya ayyuhan nas. According to some surveys, in 80 places, around 80 places, Allah says, Ya ayyuhal insan. Or things like that, which is singular. In 200 cases, Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nas. Something plural. The main target of Allah is not individuals, is the plurality, is the collective entity, and that is human society. 200 cases. When Allah talks about the reason for sending prophets, the prophets have not come only to make, you know, individuals, you know, good individuals. The prophets have come to also establish good society. Allah says, لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلَنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَنْزَلْنَا مَعْهُمُ الْإِمِيزَانِ لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ. All the messengers have been sent by Allah and have been given books and a scale. Why? So that people establish justice. Not that prophets establish justice. You know, it doesn't say لِيُقِيمُوا الْقِسْطِ. لِيَقُومَ النَّاسِ, because the prophets have come to show us so that how we establish justice. It's not that Allah wants to establish justice with his prophet and said, now you come and enjoy. لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ. The prophets teach us how to do this. But they say, you yourself must be active. So, if a prophet comes and makes, supposedly, all people good individuals, but the society lacks justice, there is no equity, There are no equal opportunities for people, for job, for education, for health, and so on and so forth. They have not been successful completely. They feel that part of the mission is still not fulfilled. Why? Because they have come to show us how to establish qist. And qist is something which is social. Qist means social justice. Even when Allah talks about, for example, purification of the soul, about taking people from darkness to light, again, it's not just for individuals. For example, Allah says to Musa alayhi salam in Surah Ibrahim number 5, أخرج قومك من الظلمات إلى النور. The whole people, the whole nation must be taken from darkness to light. Not just pick up individual and say, okay, I pick you up and I will take you to light. So, even when we look at the mission of the prophets, we see that they wanted to purify people, but also purify the society. They wanted to establish justice inside the people, but also in the society. Okay? Now, some of the things that Islamically must be present and available in Islamic community, Islamic society, or any Islamic social, you know, corporation. The first thing is that there must be balance. One of the very first requirements of Islamic community or society is that it's a balanced and moderate society. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Baqarah number 142, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. Among many qualities that Allah could have mentioned, He stresses on being balanced. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. Allama Tabatabain al-Mizan and Ayatollah Makarim Shirazi in Tafsir Namuneh, they say wasatan means mu'tadil, means balanced. An Islamic community is not extremist community in any sense. Sometimes, for example, you know, the example that Allah mentions, there are people who are only interested in worldly things. There are also, on the other hand, people who have no interest in the worldly thing. They are only thinking about, for example, spirituality. Islam says no. Dunya and Akhirah must be together. You cannot forget dunya, you cannot forget Akhirah. كُنْ لِدُنْيَاكَ كَأَنَّكَ تَعِيشُ عَبَدًا وَكُنْ لِآخِرَتِكَ كَأَنَّكَ تَمُوتُ غَدًا. With respect to dunya, you must act and plan as if you are going to be here forever. If I know that I am going to use this facility forever, then I will better use it. I will better plan it for it. You know, sometimes, unfortunately, we see that Muslim community, when they go abroad, they don't really establish themselves because they think that we are here for a short time. Why we should establish ourselves? Better not to establish so that we go back. And then you see that they are there for generations and still they have not established themselves. Sometimes, you know, even they are there for 40 years, 50 years, he says, I want to go back. Forget, you are not going back. Even if you are going back, there is no problem. You establish a society here. You establish a school, madrasa, university, hospital, everything, and go back, no problem. We don't take courage of establishing community here because we say we are not here forever. And this is wrong. Whenever you go to a place, try to have this mentality that maybe you are going to be here forever. كُنْ لَدُنْيَاكَ كَأَنَّكَ تَعِيشُ أَبَدًا. But when it comes to your akhirah, say, maybe I'm dying tomorrow. I have to be ready for that. Normally, when it comes to Akhirah, we say, no, inshallah, we are here forever. It's quite opposite. Everyone, even if he sees that everyone is dying around him, it seems that there is a kind of, you know, relaxation inside. We feel that it's not going to happen to me. And therefore, for most of the people, when their death comes, they are surprised. جَاءَهُمْ بَغْتَةً. Because I always think that it happens to others, not to me. I don't know how you think, but normally deep in our mind is that at least I have several years. Even, you know, if, for example, we really want to work for Akhirah, I say, I have few years, I have to do something. Who said you have few years? Maybe even you don't have few hours. So, a Muslim community is a community that works for dunya and akhirah. When it comes to worldly things, our community must be the best. With education, with health, with organization, with public relation, we have to be the best. But when it comes to also akhirah and thinking about our journey towards Allah, we also be the best. This is balance. Or for example, when it comes to having relation with other people, or when it comes to the having relation with the host society, you know, we have a host society and we have a community. There are people who say, you know, we should be just busy with ourselves. Forget the host society, forget the rest of people. We only have to be with ourselves. And there are people who say, we have just to mix and be part of them. We are living here, we don't have any specific identity. You have to find a balance. You have to keep your own identity very clear, but at the same time interact with the host society. You have to be a very good, active citizen of this society. And inshallah, I will explain that what type of relation we should have. It's not that, you know, we close all the, you know, circles, you know, around ourselves and isolate ourselves. We say we are a Shia community. We don't want to have any relation with others. No Sunnis, no Christians, no Jews, no people who have, for example, no faith. No. We have to interact with all different types of people, but of course in different levels. We can interact more with Sunni brothers. We can, after that, interact with our Christian brothers because they believe in God, they believe in Abraham. But even a person who has no faith but is a citizen in this society, maybe is my neighbor, there are some levels that we can interact, at least at the level of humanity. Imam Ali alayhi salam said, people are one of the two. And now Susan Fan, Imma Akhun Laka fi Din, O Nadirun Laka fi Khalq. So to be balanced means that not forget your identity, not forget your community, but at the same time, realize that you are living in a larger society. And the only way forward for us is to learn how to interact, how to engage. Or for example, when it comes to modernization, there are people who quickly accept everything which is new. Unfortunately, some people have in their mind this kind of understanding that everything which is new is better. They always want to change. Why we are changing? There are things that they are better because they have history behind them. We have to change everything. Why? Because everything is changing. If we have Salatul Jama'ah, if we have member, if we have many programs that we have had it for centuries, why we should change them? Yes, we are not against change, but not just because we want to change, we want new things. There is an alim, for example, who is good here, you know, he has been serving community for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. Everyone loves him, but say we want a new face. It's boring. Why? There is such a kind of, you know, unfortunately, understanding that we want always to be excited. We don't want, you know, continuity. We don't want, you know, a kind of line which is the same. This is wrong. On the other hand, to resist against changes which are necessary. We say, we don't bother about what is happening to the world. Everything new is better. You know, there are people who say everything new is better because this didn't exist in the time of the Prophet. This is also wrong. For us, to be new or to be old by itself doesn't mean anything. Sometimes to be new is better, sometimes to be old is better. It depends. We are rational people. We are balanced people. We are not driven by fashion. If we are driven by fashion, then we lose control. For example, you know, the role of the youths in community is very important. But on the other hand, you have to do it in a balanced way. Not that then all the elders, all the people who have experience and knowledge, they say, okay, we give everything to the youths to control. They need direction, they need guidance, they need experience. Or some people don't pay any attention to the youths. This is also bad. We have to have balance. There can be tens of examples, I don't have time, to show that how to be balanced in every experience, in every, you know, situation in our life is important. With expenditure, with programs, functions, everything. So one of the qualities of a Muslim community is that it is balanced. And then Allah says, why we have made you a balanced society? وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. So that you can be witnesses for other people. If you are a balanced society, everyone would want to follow your steps. Because people love balanced things. You can be witness. وَيَكُونُ الرَّسُولُ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِيدًا. The Prophet is witness for you, so you must follow his example. And then by forming a balanced community, other people will follow your example. We should make sure that our life is according to the Sunnah conduct of the Prophet. And then other people would find this very interesting. Inshallah, I will explain that if these qualities are there, even non-Muslims would love to become part of this community. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ma'idah number 66 talks about the people who were given Torah and Injil, and Allah says, وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ أَقَامُوا التَّوْرَاةَ وَالْإِنْجِيلَ وَمَا أُنْزِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ لَأَكَلُوا مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ وَمِنْ تَحْتَ أَرْجُلِهِمْ. If they had established Torah and Injil and what was revealed to them by Allah, they would have been able to eat from above and from under their feet. It means that the blessings of Allah would come from everywhere to them. If a society is a pious society, if they are observing Islamic guidance, not just that they pray and fast, from everything, organization, planning, after being after science, all these things, if it's Islamically done, you would be able to have blessings of Allah from every corner. There would be no poverty. In another place, Allah says, لو أن أهل القرى آمنوا واتقوا لفتحنا عليهم بركات من السماء والأرض. Because we don't have that taqwa in a full-fledged sense, not taqwa as a person, as individual, as a community, then we suffer. Then Allah says, مِنْهُمْ أُمَّةٌ مُقْتَصِدَةٌ. Some of the people of the book are balanced, are moderate, but Allah says, وَكَثِيرٌ مِنْهُمْ سَاءَ مَا يَعْمَلُونَ. But many of them do bad things. So either you are balanced or you do bad things. You understand? Those who are not balanced, they think they are good. Sometimes they think they are very good Muslim, very good Mu'min. But indeed, if they are not balanced, they do more harm than serving. Then we have cases that Allah refers to this balancedness in particular things, like for example, infaq. You know, to give charity is very important, but even when you give charity, you must not lose balance. وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا أَنْفَقُوا لَمْ يُسْرِفُوا وَلَمْ يَقْتُرُوا. If you do infaq, you must not do it too much. For example, I give everything, then my family have nothing to eat. I become bankrupt. Or I give very little. Both is bad. You have to find the balance. Or for example, Allah says, لا تجهر بصلاتك ولا تخافت بها. Don't say your salat in a very loud way, no shouting. And don't also say it so quiet that even yourself cannot understand what you say. You must find the balance. Imam Ali alayhi salam says that muttaqun have many qualities, you know, in khutbah muttaqin. One of the things that he says, mashyuhum al-tawadhu wa malbasuhum al-iqtisad. They are humble and balanced. A muttaqi is humble, very soft, and very balanced, moderate. Moderate, not in the sense of being liberal. You know, normally when we say someone is moderate, we think it's liberal. No, moderation in the sense of being balanced. The second quality of a Muslim community or a divine community is that it must be united. And because I want to talk about it a lot, I leave it for the end of my talk, but I don't know if the time permits or not. Just let me read one verse for you, but inshallah I want to come back to this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Anbiya number 92-93, إِنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَعْبُدُ. And this أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا is not even Muslim community, because Allah before that talks about other prophets. There is one community, and that is the community which starts with Adam up to the Prophet of Akhir al-Zaman, goes on till end of the world. One community. The plan was that all humanity must form one community. But unfortunately, they started being divided. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that وَتَقَطَّعُوا أَمْرَهُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ. After إِنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَعْبُدُونَ. It says وَتَقَطَّعُوا أَمْرَهُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ. But they were divided. Or for example, Allah says وَمَا كَانَ النَّاسُ إِلَّا أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً فَاخْتَلَفُوا. They were the same, but then they divided. This is not Allah's plan. Allah's plan was that we must all be together. Children of Adam must form one community. Ummatan wahida. Under one Lord. And we should work to establish this. That again, all human beings come together, but under Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not human being become themselves God. All human beings must come together under Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are other verses about this. Another quality of a Muslim community is that it is a community that is concerned about good and bad. It does amr bil ma'roof and nahi anil munkar. Enjoys the good and prohibits the bad. This is very important. Especially, you know, in liberal societies, we have to understand that without Amr al-Ma'ruf and Nahi al-Munkar, we cannot keep our community in a good direction. But on the other hand, the challenge is that in such societies, people say, even you cannot talk to your children about something that he's doing and is wrong. They say, it's none of your business. If your neighbor is doing something wrong, you cannot do anything. It's none of your business. But we have to find a wise, balanced way to do our responsibility because we care for others. If I don't care for someone, I say, okay, do whatever you want to do. You know, if you are a teacher and you see that your student has talents but is lazy, you try to help him and tell him, you know, you must work hard. Sometimes you even fix penalty, sometimes you give him prize. But if there is a student that has no talent or is very, very bad and wicked, at the end, what would you do? Say, I don't care about this student. I don't want to think or waste my time. In Islam, we do Amr wa Ma'ruf because we care. Because we feel responsible for each other. Allah says, Al-Mu'minun wal-Mu'minat ba'dhuhum awliya'u ba'd ya'muruna bil-ma'ruf wa yanhauna 'anil munkar. Because there is relation of wilaya between us. You are my wali, I am your wali, I am responsible for you, you are responsible for me, therefore we do Amr al-Ma'ruf. Otherwise we don't bother. Why we don't do Amr al-Ma'ruf with animals? Because we don't bother about their akhlaq. We do Amr al-Ma'ruf because we are concerned. Then Allah says, Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat lin-nas ta'muruna bil-ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar. You are the best nation. This is a very important concept. Please listen to this carefully. Because some people may say, oh, this is racism. You say we are chosen people. No. You know, every religion has a challenge. In a sense, they have to say to their followers that you are better than others. Because if they say to their followers that whether you follow us or not, you are not going to make any difference, so they will lose the momentum. Yeah? Any religion, any group, any party, to encourage people to follow them, they have to tell them that you are, in a sense, better. Okay? But then how do they avoid discrimination? How do they avoid racism? Some have failed. Many people say, you become part of our group or you follow our religion, you have happiness, rest of people go to hell. Rest of people, we don't bother about them. We treat them as animals. You are chosen people. Everyone must serve you. You know, such ideas exist even among some religious people. But what about Islam? Look at this beautiful ayah. You know, one wants to cry to when sees such a beauty here. Kuntum khayra ummah. You are the best nation. Ukhrijat lin-nas. You are the best nation which has been brought for the sake of people, for the benefit of mankind. Ukhrijat lin-nas, not alan-nas. Allah has not made us the best nation so that we say to people, you must serve us. We rule over you and you serve us. No, Allah says you are the best to serve. So if someone asks you, is in your understanding Muslim ummah the best ummah? We say yes. They say why? Because we say we are the best to serve. We have intention, commitment, and we know how to serve humanity. And this is our pride. You know, as the late Imam Khomeini used to say, that the leaders are servants. You are saying that if you tell me khidmat guzar, you know, khadem, servant is better. In Islam, everyone who goes higher is because he can serve better. Who is the greatest alim, who is marja? The one who can serve the community better than others. Who is the best Muslim? The one who can serve others better. Who should be the president of, for example, our community? The one who can serve others best way. Not that the one who has more money or who has a big, you know, family or gang behind him. No. To be best means to be able to serve better. Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat lin-nas. Okay, now that you want to serve humanity, what do you do? The very first thing, ta'amuruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar. If you want to help them, you have to establish values. Ma'ruf means something that people who are in the God-given state appreciate. Did you get the point? What is ma'ruf? Ma'ruf is something that every human being who has not been transformed, who is still in God-given nature, appreciates. This is ma'ruf. What is munkar? Everything that a human being who is in a good condition says it is bad. Anbiya, prophets have come just to tell us, do those things that you know they are good. Don't do those things that you know they are bad. No, and Allah says about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
He says, "Yadhu anhum israhum wal aghlal allati kanat alayhim, yuhillu lahum at-tayyibat, yuharramu alayhim al-khaba'ith, ya'muruhum bil ma'ruf, yanhahum 'anil munkar." These are the things that the Prophet knows. The Prophet wants to liberate you. The Prophet wants to help you to get rid of suspicions and suspicious ideas. The Prophet wants to you to have tayyibat, things which are pleasant. Tayyib means something that you enjoy. But you haram alayhim al-khaba'ith, and those things that makes you suffer, the Prophet said this is prohibited. Ma'ruf, you must do it. Munkar, you must not do it. So the language of the Prophet was not the language, don't get me wrong, this can be easily misunderstood. The language of the Prophet was not the language of fiqh. Because at that time fiqh was not established. So he was not telling people do wajib, not do haram. Yeah, because they didn't know what is wajib and haram. He was telling them do ma'ruf, not do munkar. Then later we've made the, you know, a kind of terminology. We say ma'ruf is wajib, munkar is haram. Yeah? But the Prophet was not talking like this. He was saying, don't kill, don't murder, don't do fornication, don't steal. Ma'ruf, munkar. Don't eat blood or drink blood. Don't attack. Yeah? Ma'ruf and munkar. Then later we gave the name of wajib and haram. What we lack today is that we are not able to convince people that wajib and haram is the same as ma'ruf and munkar. It's the same as something that you find by your own conscience to be pleasant or unpleasant. If children understand that haram is haram because it is unpleasant, because every human being who is in a good condition understands this is bad. So, kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas, ta'amuruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar. But what is the meaning of amr ma'ruf? Of course, part of it is to say ma'ruf with the conditions that we have in fiqh. But the greatest part of amr ma'ruf is through action, not through words. Imagine if we live in a society in which family values are collapsing, what is amr ma'ruf that our society can do? We go and, you know, knock the doors and say, you know, if you are doing mischief in this house, you know, we are Muslim and we want to practice Sharia. No, this is not the way we do amr ma'ruf. Or we go and shout. No. If we want to do amr ma'ruf, in addition to speaking nicely, to writing papers, you know, things like these, we ourselves in community observe Islamic values about family so well that people, by looking at us, they say, oh, we must be like Muslims. Why we are losing family? Family is something is very important. Look at Muslims, how they are strong, how parents, children are united. This is amr ma'ruf. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about salat, I don't know if you have noticed this point, that salat does nahi anil munkar. How? Inna salat tanha anil fahsha wal munkar. How does salat does nahi anil munkar? By words? Which part of salat you say don't do munkar? It's not by word. If you do proper salat, doesn't let munkar happen. Whether yourself or people who see you doing proper salat. If father, mother at home, they respect salat. And children see that when the time of salat comes, they do the best to prepare for salat. They have salat in presence of heart. No munkar happens in that house. Salat is very powerful. You know, there is hadith that Satans will escape and run away when salat is performed. So, inna salat tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. This is nahyan al munkar. Or in another place, some of mushrikeen used to say, As-salatu ka ta'amuruka an natruka ma ya'budu aba'una. This is amr ma'ruf. Salat does amr ma'ruf. Salat does nahyan al munkar. So a Muslim community, by keeping and preserving Islamic values, can do amr ma'ruf and nahi munkar. So people, by looking at our community, will realize that these values must be preserved and appreciated. It's not just a matter of talking and shouting. Another thing which is very important is that a Muslim community must be a community which is truthful. This is very important. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for example, about the community of Musa. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ومن قوم موسى أمة يهدون بالحق وبه يعدلون. This is Surah A'raf, number 159. It doesn't say all of them were like that. He says, وَمِنْ قُمْ مُوسَىٰ أُمَّةٌ. Means some of them had this quality. But we, all of us should have this quality. أُمَّةٌ يَهْدُونَ بِالْحَقِّ وَبِهِ يَعْدِلُونَ. According to Mufassirin, they say it means that some of them are those who guide the people truthfully and rule truthfully, judge truthfully. Allah praises them because they want to make sure that everything that they do is according to truth. If you want, you can follow this up in Al-Mizan, in volume 8, page 284. Of course, this is the Arabic Al-Mizan. In another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مِمَّنْ خَلَقْنَا أُمَّةٌ يَهْدُونَ بِالْحَقِّ وَبِهِ يَعْدَلُونَ. Very similar to that verse. Among those that we have created, there is a society, there is a community, there is an ummah, there is a nation, that they guide truthfully and they judge and rule truthfully. And I have a very detailed discussion here about what is the meaning and significance of truthfulness. I don't have time to discuss about this, but I can assure you that if it's not the central value, it's one of the central values in Islam, to be truthful. Haqq is something that has no second. To the extent that even when Allah wants to encourage us to worship Him and not worship idols, He says, ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْحَقِّ وَأَنَّمَا يَدْعُونَ مِنْ دُونِهِ الْبَاطِلِ. Why we should worship Allah? Because He's true. It means that if Allah was not true, if Allah was batil or asking for batil, we were not worshipping Him. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْحَقِّ وَأَنَّمَا يَدْعُونَ مِنْ دُونِهِ الْبَاطِلِ. So the most important thing that Allah has put in our heart and mind is to go after truth. All our efforts are either to discover the truth or act according to the truth. Even when it comes to sending prophets, sending Quran, everything must be according to truth. For example, Allah says, بِالْحَقِّ أَنزَلْنَاهُ وَبِالْحَقِّ نَزَلْ. We sent the Quran truthfully. The Quran came down also truthfully. Everything must be according to the truth. So if we have a Muslim community, no one should cheat, whether inside the community or with respect to others. It's impossible to have a Muslim community and then people are not trusted. People are not, you know, trustworthy. This is not a Muslim community. A Muslim community is the one that everyone in the town says, when you deal with Muslim, don't bother. They don't need even to sign anything. When they tell you something, they do it. 100% sure that Muslims are truthful, are honest. If we achieve this, we are good Muslim. If we don't achieve this, we are not good Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, was so much honest that even 13 years after the advent of Islam, mushrikeen, the pagans of Mecca, used to put their valuables as a trust with him. They didn't believe him. They said he is Majnoon, he is mad, he is magician. They tortured his people, but still in their heart, they were 100% sure that if they leave something with him, he keeps it for them. And therefore, when they wanted to go to Medina, he asked Imam Ali, before joining me, give this trust back to them and come. He didn't say, you know, these people have killed us, you know, we shouldn't bother about their valuables. Leave it in house, for example. No, he said, you must give them back. Even Imam Zainul Abidin says, if killer of my father leaves his sword as a trust with me, I should give it back to him. This is the amount of trust that must be there. And one of the things that also Quran says about haq, which is very beautiful again, haq has a nature which makes it beneficial. You know this famous verse about haq and batil, Allah compares it to rain. You know, when rain comes and then flows, and you have a little flood, for example, or, you know, river, you know, is a kind of, you know, floody, then there are lots of bubbles on the surface. And sometimes, you know, they make things, you know, very dark, unclean. Allah says batil is like these bubbles. They fill everything. You cannot see anything other than bubbles. They can, you know, fill your eyes. But Allah said, don't worry. أَمَّا الزَّبَدُ فَيَذْهَبُ جُفَاءً. These will go away. They can sometimes, you know, be the first headlines in the news, everywhere you see them, but gradually they go away. وَأَمَّا مَا يَنْفَعُ النَّاسِ فَيَمْكُثُ فِي الْأَرْضِ. The bubbles go away, but what is beneficial for people, it will remain. What is beneficial for people is haq, because Allah is talking about haq and batil. So when it comes to batil, he says it goes away. When it comes to haq, he says amma ma yanfa'u an-nas fayamkutu fil ard. So one of the characteristics of haq is that it is ma yanfa'u an-nas. If there is a thing which is not useful, it is not haq. If we spend our money on something which has no benefit, it is not haq. If we speak about the thing which is not benefiting us, it's not haq. Haq is something which is useful, and because it is useful, people don't lose it. It remains. You see, sometimes people have written books, no one reads them. The late Shaykh Abbas Qumi wrote a book, Mafatihul Janan, but he wrote it truthfully. He believed in what he wrote, also he considered the need of the people. Because he wrote this book truthfully, it remained. مَا يَنْفَعُ النَّاسِ فَيَمْكُثُ فِي الْعَرْضِ. Now you go many places, next to Quran is Mafatih in every house. Even sometimes maybe they don't have Quran, but they have Mafatih. Sometimes people travel, maybe they don't carry Quran, but they have Mafatih. Of course, inside there is some Quran, but this is something with good intention, but also good evaluation of the need of people. If your intention is good, but you don't know what benefits people, it doesn't remain. So, to be truthful is another quality of a Muslim community. Another good quality of Muslim community is justice. And because we have talked about justice, I don't want to repeat. The other quality is interest in knowledge and science. Normally we talk about significance of learning and knowledge as something personal. We all know that the Prophet ﷺ said, Talabul ilm faridatun ala kulli muslim wa ala kulli muslimin wa muslima. Every Muslim must learn. Utlubul ilm min al mahd ila Allah. Utlubul ilm walau bis-sin. When we put these three hadiths together, it means that there is no limit in distance. There is no limit in age. No matter whether you are young or old, no matter which part of the world you are, no matter how much you require to travel, there is no restriction for learning. You have to learn. And you know how a society in which the number of people who are able to read and write were less than the fingers of two hands changed to a society that became pioneers in science and philosophy. And if the things were not changed and the line that the Prophet started had continued, we're not in the situation that we have today. Muslims would be the first runners in science and technology and everything. But alhamdulillah, still we have many things to be proud of. And this is our responsibility to inshallah add to this honor for the benefit of humanity. And something very important about Muslims is that whenever they had science and technology, instead of keeping it for themselves, they said zakatul al-manashru. They said, no, we should give it to others. But there are others that when they have science and technology, they say, it's for us. You have to give us your money or oil or blood, then we give you. This is not Islamic understanding. We say zakatul al nashru. You have to give it. When it comes to learning, no limit. We don't say you should learn only from Muslim. You can learn from any person. You can teach to any person. Of course, if it comes to the things that can be confusing you, it's not like pure science. If it's about religion, it's about philosophy, you have to be a person who can discern. If I don't have enough understanding, if I don't have enough knowledge and experience, and I say to a person who is not Muslim, teach me Islam. So maybe you are then confused, you are misguided. This is another issue, you know, we shouldn't mix up things. We have to be balanced. But when it comes to physics, chemistry, other things which are pure science or, you know, applied sciences, we don't say you must be from a Muslim or from a pious person. Even maybe your professor is a very wicked person. But if he has something to offer, go and learn from him. When the Prophet said, "Utlubul ilm walau bis-seen," there were people who were doing tahajjud in China. There were people who had no faith. Even the hadith says, "Khudul hikma walau min ahlin nifaq." Even if there are hypocrites, they have some word of wisdom, go and learn. But I say again, when it comes to religion, be careful, because religion is something very sensitive, and the person must have authentic knowledge and taqwa, because otherwise he may misguide you. That's another issue. Even, you know, we have hadith that if you see there is an alim who has hubb dunya, fattahimuhu ala dinakum. Maybe this person has a good, you know, background in knowledge, but he has love for dunya. Still, there's a chance that he may misguide you. He don't says the truth, because he has hope for dunya. If he tells the truth, he will lose something. So, learning religion is different. But apart from religion, there is no limit. You can learn from any person. Okay, these are the things for individuals and for community. But there is something more for community. When we say Islam encourages to learn, encourages, you know, to, for example, develop sciences and so on and so forth, there is something more when it comes to community, when it comes to a state. We think that if we, for example, have a state in which everyone is learning and getting, for example, PhD or becomes mujtahid is enough. No. If we have a society in which we have, for example, lots of universities which are the first rank university, is it enough? No. Islamic community is a community in which individuals have highest level of knowledge, but also affairs of that community are running according to knowledge. Maybe we have a, for example, society of 100 PhD students, but everything is decided by chance. This is not Islamic community. We have best, for example, departments of economics in our country, but then when we want to plan for economy of the country, one person, for example, may decide, or for example, few people may decide. This is not Islamic community. Islamic community is that when they want to plan and run affairs and evaluate, they benefit from knowledge. They benefit from experiences. Not just that every individual has knowledge. Okay. If you have even 10 PhD, but when it comes to your management, you do it like a person who has no knowledge. This is not acceptable. This is like I told you, sometimes we have a school. Everyone is Muslim, but this school is not Islamic school. To be Islamic school means much more. So we have to benefit from the latest achievements of human beings when it comes to knowledge, to science, to experiences, to planning. At the same time, we have our own value system. There is no conflict. You know what you are after in your development, in your economics. You know, you have clear ideas about your values and your ideas, but at the same time, you benefit from experience of other people. If we want, for example, to make a mosque, we say, because we are Islamic society, so we don't want any non-Muslim engineer, you know, to give his idea. This is wrong. Even if there is an atheist engineer who has something to offer, we benefit. But we don't listen to him when he says, you know, you have to make a, you know, dancing room here in your mosque. We don't listen to him. We say what we want, but we benefit from his experience, from his knowledge, from his expertise. So a Muslim community is a community which plans and runs its affairs according to knowledge, according to experiences, according to science. Another thing which is very important is that Islamic community is a community in which there is love and mercy among its members and with outsiders. Islamic society is not a society that people fight and, you know, take guns and solve, you know, their debates with gun. Many Muslim countries, they are thousands of miles away from Islam. You see, Muslims, you know, kill each other. Two tribes kill each other. This is Islam? This is not Islam. And now you can imagine if these people had no Islam, what could have happened to them? At least Islam has limited the problem, but still they have too much problems. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, who is to be taken as a role model for us, he was a very soft person, a real gentleman. He says, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. If you do understand, what does it mean, لِنْتَ لَهُمْ? I give you one point. By the way, are you tired or not?
Okay.
What should we do? What time is Salat?
Let's take a break in 5 minutes, inshallah.
5 minutes? Then we'll have half an hour?
We'll have a break and then we'll pray, inshallah.
What time is Salat?
Prayer is 1:30, 1:35.
Mustafa, he's going to bring lunch, so when we get to the lunch, we're going to take a break.
Okay, so
let's stop for Salat, inshallah.
So 1:30. We go till Salat.
Yeah.
Okay. Look at this beautiful point. When it comes to Prophet Musa, you know, we love Prophet Musa, you know, I don't want to underestimate Prophet Musa. But just as a matter of comparison between Prophet Musa and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah says to Prophet Musa, you and your brother should go to Pharaoh and should speak to him. قُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. Go and speak to him softly. Yeah, لَيِّن means softly. لَعَلَّهُ يَتَذَكَّرُ يَخْشَى. Maybe Pharaoh remembers his relation with Allah. Maybe his heart becomes soft. Therefore, don't lose the opportunity. Don't say Pharaoh is a person that is useless to talk to him. You have to go and speak to Pharaoh, but قَوْلًا لَيِّن. Okay? Is this a command or a statement? It's a command. Qula is a command. Is it general or is it about a speech? It's about a speech. So Allah commands Musa to speak softly. Okay? So it's a command and it's not general. But when it comes to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah says, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. Is this a command or a statement? It's a statement. It's Allah is confirming. He doesn't say, be layyin. He says, you have achieved this. لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. Is this for a speech or is general? It's general. He doesn't say you are soft in speaking. He says, لِنْتَ. Your entire character is soft. He doesn't say, لِنْتَ فِي الْقُولِ. It says lenta means you are a soft person, you are a gentle person. Why? فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ. Because you have received rahmah from Allah. It's impossible to receive rahmah from Allah and be hard-hearted. Those who are hard-hearted, they don't receive rahmah from Allah. Because rahmah of Allah is so much that when you receive it, it will overflow. If you receive rahmah from Allah, then you will be nice with your husband, with your wife, with your children, with your neighbor, with animals. It's impossible to have rahmah of Allah and see a dog thirsty and say, I don't bother, this dog is najis. Even if it's a dog, you have mercy. Why? Because you are receiving rahmah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are people, you know, who sometimes you travel countries and you see, you know, they day and night receive, you know, sit in a holy place and recite Quran. There is no little rahmah in their heart. If you want to see whether you are connected to Allah, see how much you love people, how much you are kind. فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَالْبِ لَنْ فَضُّوا مِنْ حُبِّكَ. Even a person like Prophet, you know, the Prophet is very much different from us. He's a Prophet. People know he's a Prophet. And people know that he receives wahy. And people have got their Islam from him. Okay? Despite all these things, Allah says, لَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَالْبِ لَنْ فَضُّوا مِنْ حُبِّكَ. Now you wonder why people run away from us? We are not prophets, we have not shown any mojiza. They don't have their Islam from us or their religion from us. They just see our akhlaq. So you shouldn't be surprised why people run away. Why people don't come to our mosque? Because we don't have akhlaq. We don't have that softness. Who is like the Prophet? That people go to his house without permission and he doesn't stop them. Then Allah comes and intervenes and says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu la tadkhulu buyutan nabi illa an yu'dhana lakum. You know, they were mu'minin, but they didn't feel that they have to get permission. It means that this man had no guard, no security. Even he was not closing his door. And then when they were going inside, they were waiting for food. And they were looking for, you know, what type of food the Prophet had. They were looking in the, you know, food, you know, containers. Allah says, when you go, don't wait for food. Don't look at what he has. غَيْرَ نَاظَرِينَ إِنَا. And if he offers food, okay, after food, please go. فَإِذَا تَعِمْتُمْ فَانْتَشِرُوا. Because after food, they say, okay, now tell us some hadith. They had no, you know, etiquette. Anytime they were going inside, remaining there, and this man was not telling them, I have my own, you know, personal life. I have commitments. When they wanted to speak to him and they wanted him to come out, they were calling Prophet by his first name. Mohammad, come out, I want to speak to you. Who is this man? A Bedouin comes and asks Prophet to come. Then Allah says, Inna alladhina yunadunaka min wara'il hujurat aktharuhum la ya'qilun. But the Prophet didn't say, punish this man, you know, discipline this man. He has called me by my first name. No. Very soft, very kind. Even children could stop him and asking him to play with them. He was so much listening to the people. This is something that is, for me, very difficult. I don't know for you. Normally, it's very difficult to listen. Especially when people say things which are not important for you. Yeah? Sometimes people say things, you know, which are nonsense or it's not important for you. Or you have many other things in your mind, you want to concentrate. It's very difficult to listen to people. To speak is much easier than listening. Okay? But the Prophet was listening to people and never rushing them. Never interrupting them. But those people, instead of appreciating this, what did they say? وَمِنْهُمُ الَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ النَّبِيِّ وَيَقُولُونَ هُوَ أُذُنْ. In Surah Tawbah, Allah says, among them there are people who annoy the Prophet and say, this man is ear. You know, they thought there is something wrong in this man. Why this man always hears to us, listens to us? You know, they themselves, you know, sometimes you respect someone, he himself starts doubting. There must be something wrong. Why he respects me? No one respects me. So when they saw the Prophet is respecting him and listening to him, said, this man is udhun. And Allah says, قُلْ أُذُنُ خَيْرًا لَكُمْ. If his ear is a good ear for you, يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَيُؤْمِنُ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. He believes in God and trusts in you and loves you. This is a miracle. You be a person that Jibreel seeks permission to come and speak to you, okay? Then you let people to say nonsense. And you listen. This is akhlaq of the Prophet. You know the story of that lady who was a believer in another religion, throwing always, you know, dust and, you know, rubbish. One day she was not there. The Prophet said, we had a friend every day, you know, he was welcoming us. Where is that person? Said his Eve. The Prophet went and visited that person, and that person was changed. So, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ لِمْتَ لَهُمْ. Islamic society must be a society in which there are gentle men and gentle women, soft men and soft women. Then you may say, Mawlana, but we have serious issues. What about them? If we are too lenient, then we cannot make any progress. And the answer is given by Imam Ali alayhi salam. Sometimes I say, I wish these few words of Imam Ali can be written and put in a frame in Khutbah Muttaqin. Imam Ali alayhi salam says, فَمِنْ عَلَامَةَ أَحَدِهِمْ. Among the signs of Muttaqin is this, أَنَّكَ تَرَى لَهُ قُوَّةً فِي دِينَ وَحَزْمًا فِي لِين. You see that muttaqin are very strong in their iman, but at the same time they are far-sighted and they are soft. قُوَّةً فِي دِين وَحَزْمًا فِي لِين. We normally cannot have these three together. If I am a strong mu'min, I think I have to shout and I have to fight. I have to be aggressive. You cannot learn how to be soft and at the same time be strong. And at the same time, plan. Many mu'mineen, they don't plan. They don't have, you know, this far-sighted vision. They say, trust Allah, tawakkul. Allah sorts out everything. قُوَّةً فِي دِين وَحَزْمًا فِي لِين. You can be very strong in mu'min. تَزُولُ الْجِبَالُ وَلَا تَزُولُ. When it comes to your principles, no one can take it from you. But at the same time, be polite, be soft, be nice, meet, talk, engage. Why we have to fight, or why to have be too liberal? There is a balance here. قُوَّةً فِي دِينٍ وَحَزْمًا فِي لِينٍ. Has means to have vision for future, to plan for future. So, in Islamic community, people should be very kind with each other, with outsiders. In Islamic community, we should be hospitable. You know, hospitality is very important. Normally, we think hospitality is a personal issue. If someone comes to your house, alhamdulillah, we Muslims are very hospitable. Yeah? If someone comes to our house, we don't say, you know, go, I am busy. We say, please, you know, come in. Then you provide everything that, even if you don't have money, you borrow to look after your guest. Because we know that hospitality is very important. There is hadith, مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيُكْرِمْ ضَيْفَهُ. Whoever believes in Allah and the hereafter must honor his guest. Okay? But what about a community? We haven't taken this that further. How can a community be hospitable? We know that if someone comes to my house, how to be hospitable. But we don't know how to be hospitable as a community. If someone comes to our mosque, if there are refugees who come to our country, if there are tourists or visitors who come to our country, we don't know how as a community or as a society to be hospitable. When they come to our house, we are ready to die for them. But on the street, we treat them like animals, na'uzubillah. This is not Islamic community. The same person that in a street, if he dies, no one pays attention. If he comes to their house, they die for him. Why? Because we haven't understood that this is also a social value. It's not just personal value. I'm not saying this is always the case. No, alhamdulillah, when it comes to looking after refugees, you know, we have some of the best records in many cases. But I'm saying in general, Sometimes people come, for example, they don't have our language. A tourist comes to our town. Maybe we are in a holy city. A tourist comes to Qom, to Najaf, to Mashhad, to Karbala. What have we planned for them? Sometimes I say to people in Qom that Qom as an international city must make itself ready. If a Zawar, a Zair comes and then, na'uzubillah, someone mistreats him. He wants to take him to the court. In which court of Qom we have a person who speaks English? Forget Chinese or, you know, Spanish. We have to have part of the court ready for the Zawar. If someone has accident, there must be a clinic for Zawar who come from other countries. I don't know, maybe there is there, but I don't know if there is such a thing. So these are the things that as a community we have to think about it. I cannot say, okay, if anyone comes to my house, I show hospitality. Now, when they come to our town, when they come to our mosque, we should be hospitable. We have to plan. Sometimes some convert brothers and sisters say, no, we are afraid of entering to some mosque because we feel that if we go there, we are treated as a stranger. This is not hospitality. Indeed, when it comes to the mosque, even it is not a matter of hospitality because everyone has right, the same as me. So mosque is not mine. I can say my house is mine, his guest. But in the mosque, no one is guest. Every Muslim owns mosque like me because it belongs to Allah. And Allah says about Masjid al-Haram, which is Baytullah, at the same time says, "Inna awwala baytan wudha'a lin-nas lalladhi bi-Bakkah mubarak." Mosque is for everyone. So this is another quality that we should be hospitable. Another thing is that we have to be very punctual and organized. Not only as a person, again as a community as well. A community which is organized, which is punctual. When we say we have a function or we want to deliver something, you know, must be everything in a very organized, punctual way. And finally, an Islamic community is a community in which people are ready to give what they need to their brothers and sisters, not extra. Sometimes I have extra. I have, for example, two laptops. I need one. I give one to my brother. But sometimes I have only one. But he has a project. He has exam. He needs that. I want just to check my email. But he has exam tomorrow. I give my laptop to my brother. يُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةً. It's more than muwasat, it's ithar, means they give priority to their brothers and sisters. And now, I want to reflect on this for about 10-15 minutes to see that this is the real meaning of wilaya. I don't know, we should do it after Salat?
Take a break right now.
Yeah, so inshallah after Salat, yeah, so we will have lunch, then Salat, after that, at least 15 minutes, we have something more important than whatever I have said so far. So don't disappear. Okay? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah al-Aliyy al-Azim. الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وعلي محمد
وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وجعلنا من أعوان الأنصار إن شاء الله. I am going to finish in about 20 minutes. Then we will be divided into smaller groups for discussion. And I will tell you what should we discuss. And then we come together again, and every group, you know, shares the conclusions that they had. And then, inshallah, I will wrap up. Let's first recite together this dua faraj. Allahumma kull waliyyaka al-hujjata ibn al-hasan salawatuka alayhi wa ala abaihi fi hadhihi sa'ati wa fi kulli sa'ah waliyyan wa hafidhan wa qa'idan wa nasira wa dalilan wa inna hatta tuskinahu ardaka taw'a wa tumatta'ahu fiha tabi'a. Allahumma salam. One of the characteristics of a Muslim community that is very important is the unity which exists among the members of the community. Perhaps this is the most important thing, and if we have this unity, we would be able to achieve the rest. If we don't have this unity, whatever we have will be lost. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً. In Arabic, إِنَّمَا is not just for emphasis. It's not like enna. If we say enna al-mu'minin ikhwa, it means truly believers are brothers. But when we say ennama, not only it means truly, but it means that this is the case and nothing else. It shows exclusiveness. Ennama al-mu'minuna ikhwa means there is no other way to think about the relation between mu'mineen. Mu'mineen are brothers and sisters. When we read this ayah, we think that perhaps this is a kind of exaggeration. We don't say this, but in our hearts, how can I be brother of someone that has no blood relation with me? How can I be brother of someone who doesn't look like me? How can I be sister of someone who doesn't speak my language? It means that we have to be nice with each other. But this is not the case. This is a real thing. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً. So now I want to explain that what type of brotherhood and sisterhood must exist in an Islamic community, especially the community that follows Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. When we refer to our hadith, we find that our imams have told us that Islam is built on several foundations. Bunya al-Islam ala khams. There are five things that are foundations of Islam or pillars of Islam. Salat is one of them. Zakat is one of them. We have Hajj, we have Jihad, these are all very important. But Wilaya is the most important one. And Imam says, وَمَا نُودِيَ بِشَيْءٍ كَمَا نُودِيَ بِالْوِلَايَةِ or وَلَمْ يُنَادَ بِشَيْءٍ كَمَا نُودِيَ بِالْوِلَايَةِ. Nothing is like Wilaya. Salat is very important. Zakat is very important. All these furu'd-din are very important. But nothing is like wilaya. What is wilaya? Wilaya is the spirit of Islam. Wilaya is the life of Islam. If a person has salat, zakat, hajj, Amr al-Ma'ruf, everything, all the furu, but doesn't have wilaya, he doesn't know Imam, he doesn't know Ahlul Bayt, this person has all the parts of Islam, Therefore, he is considered as a Muslim. But his Islam doesn't function because there is no spirit. There is no life. Wilaya is nothing like a part next to other parts. You know, anyone who denies one part of Islam would not be a Muslim. If someone denies Salat or Zakat, he's not a Muslim. But if you deny Wilaya, you are still a Muslim. Because Wilaya is not part of Islam. Wilaya is Ruh, is the spirit, is the life, is the energy. If a person doesn't have Wilaya, he's a Muslim, he may even be, inshallah, able to go to heaven if he did not deny the truth, if he did not, you know, ignore the necessity of searching for truth. I don't want to talk about that, inshallah. Many of them will go to heaven, man. I pray that as much as possible they go to heaven. As we have in our hadith, that's not an issue. I'm not against any group of Muslims. But I'm saying that there is a big difference between the one who has wilayah and the one who has missed. The difference is like the one who has a very, you know, healthy body, but just because of, for example, a heart attack died. Body is good, not damaged, but there is no ruh, there is no life, there is no activity, there is no direction, there is no reaction. And therefore, you know, as we said yesterday, Sunni Shia all have said, man mata wa lam ya'rif imama zamanihi mata mitatal jahiliyah. He has Islam, but he's like the people before Islam. Okay. What I want to share with you is a new understanding of wilayah. It's new, of course, for us, but it is not new to Islam, it's not new to our sources. It's something that for us is maybe new. Normally, when we talk about wilaya, we think that wilaya is something personal, something that every individual must achieve. A relation that exists between every single mu'min and Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, and in particular Imam of the age. My wilaya has nothing to do with your wilaya. This is what normally we understand. Wilaya is something between an Imam. Imam knows how much I love him or I don't love him, how much I am committed to his cause or not, between me and Imam. Yes, I have this journey and I meet my brothers and sisters in faith. I have to also treat them in a nice way because they are also Muslim, they are mu'min, they have wilaya. But it is my own business. Nothing has anything to do with this wilaya of me. You have the same understanding. What this false understanding has led to is that every person now lives in his own world. Every person is trying to please Imam Zaman or Ahlul Bayt regardless of what is happening to the community, what others are doing, because we think that everyone should directly be connected to Imam. It's like what? It's like, for example, my hand says I want to be connected to brain. I don't bother about the rest of body. My foot says I want to be connected to the brain. I don't bother about the rest. This doesn't work. مثل المؤمنين في توادهم وتراحمهم وتعاطفهم كمثل الجسد. The example of believers in their love, in their affection, in their sympathy, in their mercy for each other is like one body. If one part of body has a problem, it will affect all body. If there is infection in one part of body, whole body will have fever. If your, for example, head or your, I don't know, tooth has a pain, you cannot sleep. Mu'mineen are cells and organs of one body. It's impossible for mu'mineen to think that they can be connected to the heart and brain of this body regardless of the rest of body. It's impossible to think that you can please Imam Zaman without knowing what is happening to community of Imam Zaman. It's impossible. When we reflect on the Quran and Hadith, we realize that wilaya is a relation that connects all of us with each other and with Imam. Now, like for example, if you have tasbih, okay? Every seed in tasbih must be connected with a thread to the rest of tasbih. Wilaya is that thread that connects all seeds with each other. Therefore, what we find in our hadith and Quran is that Imam is our wali, we are also his wali. At the same time, we are wali of each other. You are my wali, I am your wali. Imam is my wali, I am his wali. The same is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is our wali, we should also be his wali. Allahu waliyyu alladhina amanu inna awliya Allah la khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun. Imam Ali is our mawla and wali, we are also their awliya. And we are wali for each other. And al-mu'minun wal-mu'minat ba'dhuhum awliya ba'd. So wilaya is something that connects all mu'minin together and with Imam. What is this wilaya? Many people ask, what is wilaya? It's very difficult to translate it. If you say guardianship, friendship, leadership, none of them is enough. And sometimes they are not accurate actually. Because if I say wilaya is leadership, then how can I be wali for Imam? Or wali for God? Yeah? Because wilaya is used in the Quran in a mutual way. If I say wilaya means guardian, so how can I say I am guardian of Allah? Allah is my guardian, but we say inna awliya Allah. We cannot say these are guardians of Allah. So what is wilaya? Have you got any suggestion?
Someone who supports you, possibly.
Can we support Allah? Because you have to translate it in the way that in all these cases it can be used. For example, when the Prophet said, "Man kuntu mawla, fahada aliyun mawla, Allahumma valiman wala." So here, Prophet is our wali, but then it says, "Allahumma valiman wala," or Allah be wali of whoever takes Ali as his wali. What does it mean? You have to find a meaning that can be used in all these cases. Any suggestion? Yes. Friend is not enough. You can be friend even with those who have no wilaya. Guardian is not possible to be used from bottom to top. Top to bottom you can say guardian, but bottom to top you cannot. I cannot say I'm guardian of Allah.
In connection?
Muhib is not enough. To love is not enough.
In connection?
Connection can be negative or positive. Yeah. It's very difficult to find a word that can translate, but inshallah I will give you a word. Before we come to that point, I mentioned three aspects of wilaya. There are three aspects in wilaya, that if these three are together, there is relation of wilaya. If one of these is missing, there is no wilaya. Okay? One is ma'rifa, knowledge. Wilaya needs ma'rifa. If you don't know your Imam, there is no wilaya. Or if Imam doesn't know you, there's no wilaya. There must be ma'rifa, there must be knowledge. And this is why we have man mata wa lam ya'rif imam al-zamane, or for example, we have about ziyarat that arifan bihaqqih. This ma'rifa is very important. I don't have time to explain this ma'rifa, but for the sisters a little bit, we talked about this yesterday. The second thing is love. Ma'rifah leads to love. If you know Imam, you cannot do anything other than loving him. And Imam loves us more than we love him. The love that Imam has for us is much more than the love that we have for Imam. Not only that, even Hadith says that we love you more than you love yourself. Imam loves me more than I love myself. Velaya has to have love. And then obedience, ta'ah. If you have ma'rifah and love and obedience, this is velaya. In relations that exist in dunya other than velaya, normally they only want from you obedience. Love is not important. You know, if you work in an office or if you're a member of a party, what is important is to take whatever they say, you know, seriously and listen to them, you know, implement their commands. You may hate your, you know, boss, but still you get good salary. Yeah? Maybe you are a doctor, you hate the patient, the sick person, but you offer him good treatment. So they say, you know, you are a good doctor. But in velaya, there must be love. If you do everything that Imam asks from you, but you don't love him, you don't have velaya. Indeed, we obey him because we love him, not we obey him because we are afraid of him. Why do you bring water for your mother when she says, bring me water? Are you afraid of her? Or you love her? Because you love her, you want to do something to please her. When there is relation of velaya, we obey the one who has velaya, whether it is imam or is a mu'min, because inshallah, if we have time, I will explain that even mu'minin have the right of obedience, and therefore they can do amr ma'ruf. You have right over me to obey you when you tell me something good. I cannot say it's none of your business. You have velaya over me. At the same time, if you do something wrong, I can tell you, please do it rightly. It's mutual. But this is all based on ma'rifah and love. Because we care about each other. We love each other. We feel that our connection is interdependent. So, velaya is based on three things. Knowledge, love, and obedience. Okay. When it comes to finding a word for velaya, the best thing that I know, maybe you find inshallah something better. Velaya means belonging to the same camp. Velaya means belonging to the same party. You can be head of this party, you can be a simple member of this party, but you belong to this party. And this is party of Allah. Therefore, Allah is Wali, Imam is the leader, and members are fellow mu'mineen, but among them also there might be hierarchy. But all are members of one party, one camp, one group. What keeps them together? Having the same ideals. Having the same direction in their life. Being committed to the truth. And opposite to this, velaya is adawa, enemy. Wali is opposite to adov. Adov is the one who belongs to the opposite camp. Instead of Allah, they have shaitan. Instead of Prophet and Imam, they have Fir'aun and Namrud. And then under that, there are members of that camp. But it's not that everyone is either in this camp or that camp. Everyone is either with us or against us. No. And there are in between a great amount of people, great percentage of people are neither in this camp or that camp. It's to the people who are in the right camp to reach out and absorb them. Allah says in the Quran, لا إله إلا ولا إله إلا. There are people who are muzabzabin. They don't know what to do. They have not decided. And I tell you, the great success of all the prophets and reformers always come when they manage to reach out and bring these people who are in middle, who have good will, good heart, but no direction. You shouldn't assume everyone is against you, everyone is your enemy. This is a very big strategic mistake. Majority of people are not against us. Maybe in the whole world there are very few wicked people. Majority of people want good things. They don't know. So, Vilaya is to be in this camp. And in this camp, belonging to this camp, this membership is something that exists in all different levels. Okay. If you are a member of a camp, a member of a party, a member of a group, a member of an organization, what should you do? You should know about the entire group. You should know your policies, you should know your aims and objectives. You should know everyone who is working for you or with you. And at the same time, you should know what the opposite camp is doing. You know, if you are, for example, a football team, you cannot say, okay, I want to know everything about my team, but I don't know what is the team that you are going to play against. You should know also everything about what they are doing. You try to strengthen your relation inside your team, and also you try to do bara, means distancing yourself from the opposite team. Therefore, velaya comes with bara, tavalli and tabarri. And if you notice, when our ulama mentioned tavalli and tabarri, velaya and bara, they mention it as uddin. Why they say this is for who? Normally, when we define tavalli and tabarri, we define it as a doctrine. But all ulama have put it as a furu, which is a practical thing. Why tavalli and tabarri is put next to salat and zakat? Because velaya is something that must be practiced. It's not something that you just believe. You understand? If someone says, I believe in salat, but I never say salat, it's not accepted. It's not like Tawheed that you believe in Tawheed. Velaya is something that you have to practice. It's not enough to say that I know Mu'minin are brothers. I know Mu'minin must love each other. No, you must practice. So, when you are a member of a group that have the same cause, the same aims and objectives, the same leader, then what keeps you together is ma'rifah, is love and obedience, which is mutual. You see that in our ziyarat, in our du'as, there are lots of hints to this aspect of velaya, which unfortunately we have missed. We have not taken them seriously. We have achieved velaya, but only as a shell. We haven't gone into the core of velaya. And this is why our communities are not that united. Because we have not realized that velaya is not just to love Imam. Velaya is to love Imam and love followers of Imam. We haven't understood this. Velaya is not to be able to spend tens of thousands of dollars for Imam Hussein. It's not just this. Velaya is to be able to give your money to a Shia of Hussein, not just to Hussein himself. Now we say, you know, this Shia brother or sister has enough money. He says, I don't have money. But he said, we want to have majlis for Imam Hussein. Please, this is my money. If you really love Imam Hussein alayhi salam, you realize that to give to a person who belongs to Imam is giving to Imam. If, for example, today there is a child of Imam, you know, asking us for help, he said, no, I give only to your father. I don't give it to you. If Hazrat Ali Akbar, for example, is today, he said, we don't give it to you, we give you to your father. It doesn't make sense, it's ridiculous. The same is with a wali of Imam Hussein, a person who has wilaya of Hussein. If you look at, for example, Ziyarat Ashura, we say to Imam Hussein alayhi salam, Ya Abu Abdullah, Inni Salmun Laman Salamakum wa Harbun Laman Harabakum. How many of you can honestly tell this to Imam Hussein? You can easily say, Inni Salmun Lakum, I am at peace with you. But to say, I am at peace with whoever is at peace with you, is very difficult. It means that you must not done anything against any Shia. Inni Salmun Laman Salamakum. Because that person, even if he's bad with me, he has no problem with Imam Hussein. Maybe he doesn't respect me, maybe he's not polite with me. But he doesn't have problem with Hussein. Inni Salmun Laman Salamakum wa Harbun Laman Harabakum. If I have any problem, it's because of you, not because of my personal issues. You know how much you have to be mature, how much you have to have control over your emotions. That when there is a person who is connected to Imam Hussein, you don't fight him back. Like for example, your brother and sister. Because your brother and sister is connected to you through your father and mother, you never fight them back. At least up to now it's like this, inshallah. In future remains like this, because sometimes now brothers and sisters are fighting. Because you love your father and mother, you love your brother and sister, and you never fight him back. I know that is my brother. Even if he's angry with me, he doesn't, you know, really want to harm me. And even if he wants to harm me, I say, okay, my brother, because of my father, because of my mother, I forgive him. إِنِّي سَلْمٌ لِمَنْ صَالَمَكُمْ. I am at peace with whoever is at peace with you. And this is repeated in Ziyarat Ashura again, twice. إِنِّي سَلْمٌ لِمَنْ صَالَمَكُمْ وَحَرْبٌ لِمَنْ خَارَبَكُمْ. Again, إِنِّي سَلْمٌ لِمَنْ صَالَمَكُمْ وَحَرْبٌ لِمَنْ خَارَبَكُمْ. But the second time has addition. وَوَلِيٌّ لِمَنْ وَالَاكُمْ. Whoever has your wilaya, I have his wilaya. Whoever is at your service, I am at his service. It's beautiful. وَلِيٌّ لِمَنْ وَالَاكُمْ. وَعَدُوٌّ لِمَنْ عَادَاكُمْ. Who is against you, I am against him. I don't have any personal business here. I haven't opened any account for me to put things inside. I have only one account, and that is for my master. You are not kind with me, no problem. As long as you are doing good things for my imam, for community, I am at your service. In Ziyarat Ashura we say, Ya Aba Abdullah, Inni atakarrabu ila Allah, wa ila Rasulihi, wa ila Amir al-Mu'mineen, wa ila Fatima, wa ila al-Hasan, wa ilayka bimuwalatik, wa bilbara'ati min a'la. I seek closeness to Allah, to the Prophet, to Imam Ali, to Lady Fatima, to Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein by two things. By having your wilaya and by distancing myself from your enemies. But the second time, which this is repeated, has an addition again. أَتَغَرَّبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ ثُمَّ إِلَيْكُمْ. This kum was mentioned, means five. Because it said, إِلَى اللَّهِ وَإِلَى رَسُولِهِ وَإِلَى أَمِيرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Now we say, إِلَيْكُمْ. بِمُوَالَاتِكُمْ وَمُوَالَاتِ وَلِيِّكُمْ. Muwalatakum means your wilaya. Muwalat waliyakum means wilaya of whoever has your wilaya. If you want to get close to Allah, you have to strengthen your own relations and ties. It's not just doing good things. The more you love your brothers and sisters, the more you serve your brothers and sisters, the closer you are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more you help your brothers and sisters, the closer you are to Imam Zaman. This is the secret. We say, As'alullah alladhi akramani bi ma'rifatikum wa ma'rifati awliya'ikum wa razaqani al-bara'ata min a'da'ikum an yaj'alani ma'akum fi dunya wal akhirah. Allah has honored me by knowing you and knowing your awliya. It's an honor for you that if you know what is happening to the community. Normally we don't think this is an obligation. Why should I know about what is happening to the universal community of Ahlul Bayt? Why I should know? Why should I bother? He says, this is necessary. How can you know Imam without knowing his camp, without knowing people who are under him? You cannot say, I don't bother about the rest of this body. أَكْرَمَنِي بِمَعْرِفَتِكُمْ وَمَعْرِفَتِ أَوْلِيَاكُمْ. We have to have knowledge of Imam and his awliya, and to be distanced from enemies. Then you can hope to be أَنْ يَجْعَلَنِي مَعَكُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. How can we be in dunya with Ahlul Bayt? Question. If someone asks you, how can I be with Ahlul Bayt in dunya? If you want to be with Lady Fatima or Imam Mahdi in dunya, what can you do? Is there any place that you have to go? Do you have such a thing that all the Shia must have come and, you know, settle in the town that we live there or we are buried there? We don't have such a thing. How can we be with them? And يَجْعَلَنِي مَعَكُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا, what does it mean? When you are together in the camp, you are with Imam. When you are working together for the cause of Imam, you are with Imam, no matter which part of dunya you are. If someone is working in a very remote island in Pacific Ocean for the United Nations, yeah, they have sent a person for a mission. As long as he is connected and is receiving instruction and work for them and reports back to them, they say he is with us. Yeah? Maybe he's thousands of miles away, but they say this is with us. And there is a person inside the building of United Nations, but having nothing to do with them, they say he's a visitor. He's not with us. Or maybe he's a thief. They phone police to arrest him. He is inside the building, but he's not with us. He's thousands of miles away, he's with us. Maybe there is a person in Medina, but not with the Prophet. And there is always a Quran in Yemen, and he is with Prophet. So it's not a matter of distance, it's not a matter of even time. Even it's not a matter of time. You can be with Imam Ali right now. A person told Imam Ali alayhi salam after one of the battles, you know, Imam had victory, he said, I wish my brother was with us. Imam Ali asked him something very important. He said, Ahawa akhi ka ma'na. Is it the wish of your brother to be with us? Does he love to be with us? He said, yes. Then Imam said, so he has been with us. Shahidana fi mu'askarana haza. He was with us, and not only that, Imam says, everyone also who has the same understanding with us, even if they are not yet born, sayar'afu bihimu zaman. Gradually they will be brought out by time. If you today have the same understanding that the Shia of Imam Ali had, you are with them. If you have the same understanding of companions of Imam Hussein, you are with them. Ya laytani kuntu ma'akum fa'afuza fawzan adima. It's not just a dream. By saying this, really, you become part of them. If you are really saying this. So, geographical location is not important. Time is not important. Color, language, ethnicity, genetic, nothing is important. You can be Salman Farsi As-Salman minna ahl al-bayt. And you can be a son of Imam, like son of Imam Hadi, who was not a good person, Ja'far al-Kazzab. Son of Nuh was not from him. Innahu laysa min ahlik, innahu amalun ghayru salih. Okay. So, an yaj'alani ma'akum fi dunya means to be working with them and their followers for the same cause, no matter where you are. In this way, if you are together, you are with them. And what about akhirah? For sure, whoever was with them in dunya, in akhirah will be with them. This is guaranteed. If you have been in a camp in dunya, in akhirah you will be with the same people. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that on the day of judgment, people come as individuals. لَقَدْ جَئْتُمُونَا فُرَادًا. You know, furada means individuals. You know, we say salatul jama'a, salat furada means individuals. Or kullun atiya yawm al-qiyamata farda means one by one. So on the day of judgment, everyone comes individually. But then what happens is that yawma nad'u kulla unasin bi imamihim. Then Allah asks everyone to stand behind his leader. Some people stand behind Fir'aun. What does Pharaoh do with them? First of all, he says, I want to get rid of these people. Estabarra alladhina tubi'u min alladhina tabahu. They say, you know, I have nothing to do with these people. I have enough problem. But it's impossible. You have misguided them in dunya. In akhirah also, these are headache for you. You have to answer to Allah. And those people who have followed Pharaoh, when they see this, they say, Ya layta lana karratan fanatabarra'a minhum kama tabarra'u minna. We wish we were able to go back to dunya and distance ourselves from Pharaoh. Pharaoh has no love, no mercy for us. He says, I don't know them, I don't care about them. But they have to be together. يَقْدُمُ قَوْمَهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَأَوْرَدَهُمُ النَّارِ. He leads them in Qiyamah to hell. Because in dunya, he was their leader. In akhirah, he leads them towards hell. But those who have followed Ibrahim, Musa, Isa, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
They will take them to heaven. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam said, and this hadith is in Al-Mizan and Tafsir al-Hunay, that أَلَيْسَ الْعَدْلُ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ إِذَا جَاءَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. When the day of judgment comes, the justice of Allah is that He calls every group of people to join the one that they had His wilayah. We go and hold on to the Prophet and you will come to us. فَزَعْتُمْ إِلَيْنَا. You come to us, we follow the Prophet. Then Imam said, "Ela ayna tarawna yudhhabu bikum." Then you think you will be taken to what place? Where will you be taken? Imagine, on the day of judgment, if we are inshallah reaching that point, that we are able to join the Prophet and Ahlul Bayt, where will they take us? Imam said three times, "Ela al-jannati wa rabbil ka'bah." قالها ثلاث مرات. Three times said by the Lord of Kaaba to heaven. So if in dunya we are with them, in akhirah we will be with them. And يجعلني معكم في الدنيا والآخرة. If in dunya we had just their names, my name is Muhammad Ali, it's not enough. It's not a matter of name. It's a matter of reality. If in dunya I have been working for them, I have been working with their people, I love them, then in akhirah inshallah we will be together. So it's interesting that in dunya our destiny is interconnected. Even in akhirah we cannot run away from each other. We are together inshallah. And then we say, I ask so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give me tawfiq that I will have firm standpoint with you. يُثَبِّتَ لِي قَدَمَ صِدْقٍ عِنْدَكُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. If you want to have firm standpoint, if you want not to collapse, not to deviate, not to go astray, you have to be together. And inshallah, then in akhirah also you will not deviate. And something unbelievable. وَأَسْأَلُهُ أَنْ يُبَلِّغَنِ الْمَقَامَ الْمَحْمُودَ لَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهِ. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make me reach the praised position that you have. This Maqam-e-Mahmood is not mine. You know, the Prophet struggled so much to achieve Maqam-e-Mahmood. مِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَتَحَجَّدْ بِهِ نَافِلَةً لَكْ عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَبْعَثَكَ رَبُّكَ مَقَامًا مَحْمُودًا. He was doing tahajjud great part of the night, and Allah said, maybe you achieve Maqam-e-Mahmood. But because the Prophet doesn't go alone, he takes his people with him. So we say, أَنْ يُبَلِّغَنِ الْمَقَامَ الْمَحْمُودَ لَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. That is for you with Allah, close to Allah, but I want to reach there. Don't forget me. I am with you. When a king travels, he takes even his chief and servants, everyone with him. The king doesn't say, okay, you remain in the airport, I'm going to the hotel. He takes them. In dunya, we have to be together. Inshallah, in akhirah, they will make sure that we are together with them. In dua nudbah, I think I spoke more than 20. In dua nudbah, we say, هَلْ مِنْ مُعِينٍ فَأُطِيلَ مَعْهُ الْعَوِيلَ وَالْبُكَى. O Imam Zaman, is there anyone who can help me when I want to cry? He or she helps me so that we can cry longer. Many people don't notice this point. It doesn't say فَأَبْكِي مَعَهُ, I cry with him. It says أُطِيلَ مَعَهُ, I cry longer. If I have a brother or sister who works with me for the same cause, I gain more energy. I can do more work. And then, هَلْ مِنْ جَزُوعٍ فَأُصَاعِدَ جَزَاهُ. Is there anyone lamenting for you that I help him? In the first sentence you say, is there any helper? In the second you say, is there anyone that I help him? A moment is not only expecting help, says, what can I do for you? Before people ask you for help, you should offer help. فَأُصَاعِدَ جَذَعَهُ إِذَا خَلَى. What does it mean, إِذَا خَلَى? It means in private, when he's alone. If there is a community in which the Shia only meet in mosque and Husainiya, this is not a Shia community. The Shia must be so close that in khalwa, in public and private, they meet each other. Can you say to your father or your sister, I only meet you in the mosque? Yes, with, you know, strangers or people you don't know, you meet them in the public places. You must be so close that you are one family. As our khala. هَلْ قَضِيَتْ عَيْنٌ فَسَاعَدَتْهَا عَيْنِي عَلَى الْقَضَى. You know قَذِيَتْ عَيْنٌ. Amir al-Mu'minin said سَبَرْتُمَ فِي الْعَيْنِ قَضَى وَفِي الْحَلْقِ شَجَى. Sometimes, you know, your eyes are bruised or injured because something goes there and it's sharp. It makes your eyes, you know, painful. Red and painful. Okay? Mu'minin, because they miss Imam Zaman, and they see all the problems, they cry very much for Imam Zaman. Okay? Therefore, their eyes becomes red. You say to Imam Zaman, هَلْ قَذِيَتْ عَيْنٌ. Is anyone who has reached this point, so my eyes take part of the pain, and then that person will be relieved. فَسَاعَدَتْهَا عَيْنِي عَلَى الْقَضَى. When your child has fever, if you cannot do anything to stop his fever, you say, oh Allah, please let the fever come to me. I don't want to see my child suffering. When I see my brother and sister in face suffering, I say, oh Allah, my eye, which is the most sensitive part of my body, is ready to take part of the pain. In the first sentence, you ask for helper. In the second sentence, you offer help. In the third sentence, also you offer help. Usa'ida sa'adatha 'ayni. And there are many things like this in du'as, in du'a-i ahd, in du'a-i iftita'. In many places, if you are interested, inshallah, listen to the lecture on collective nature of belaya online. The Stockholm version, which is maybe more detailed. You see lots of reference for this. So now, this is the question for our, inshallah, discussion. For sure, no one can say we have reached this level. This level of being close, united, intimate, we haven't reached this. And for sure, as long as we are in this condition, Imam Zaman will not come. I promise you, he will never come when we are in this condition. You say, Mawlana, why you say this? Because this is what Ahlul Bayt have said us. Imam Baqir alayhi salam, was told by a person from the city of Kufa. His name was Buraid al-Ijli. He said, oh Imam, you have lots of Shia in Kufa. Tens of thousands of Shia in town. Many centers and mosques, many ulama, many good youths. Oh Imam, please come. Maybe you in Detroit also, Dearborn, say this to Imam. Imam, there are tens of thousands of people. We have educated people, we have mosques, you know, we have money. Imam Baqir alayhi salam wants to test. He doesn't want to be deceived. What does he say? He didn't say how many you are, how much money you have, how much weapon you have. No, these are not important. They don't need weapon, they don't need money, they don't need number. Imam, it's stressed on one point. أَيَّضَعُ أَحَدُكُمْ يَدَهُ فِي كِيسَ أَخِيهِ فَيَأْخُذُ حَاجَتَهُ. I only ask you one thing. Are you so close to each other that if one of you needs money, can put his hand in the pocket of his brother? His brother is not here, but his coat is here hanging, and he needs money. Does he feel that he has permission, and his brother would not mind if he takes money? He said, no. And I think he was surprised. Why Imam asked me such a question? This is not relevant. Then Imam said, فَهُمْ بِالدِّمَاءِهِمْ أَبْخَلَ. If they are not ready to give money to each other, then they will not be able to give blood. Imam doesn't want money for himself. He didn't say, are they ready to give me money? This is not the test. Although many people fail even in this test, they don't pay homes. This is a big failure. But even if you pay money to Imam without any hesitation, this is not enough. How much you are able to give money to your brother and sister? Even to the extent that they should not need permission if you are not available. Of course, you may say there are people who misuse, there are people who take advantage. I know, but we can have a system. Maybe I cannot let everyone to put his hand in my pocket. There are tens of thousands of hands. But if we are a united community, we leave everything to be decided by the community. We establish a system and we say to the system, that whenever the community as a whole comes to a conclusion that we need money, my pocket is yours. I am sure you don't ignore my own needs, you don't make me bankrupt, you don't make me poor, but I leave it to you. Because there is love, there is trust, there is understanding. Have we reached this point? So if Imam Baqir does not accept the offer of people of Kufa for uprising against Bani Umayyah, who didn't have that much power and they were just in a small part of the world. Then Imam Mahdi would accept our offer to start his universal mission, which would be the last chance. We cannot take any risk. If Imam Badr was going to fail, okay, after the Imam Sadr, would be Imam Qasim. Imam Mahdi is not going to take any risk. The moment you can say to Imam that, oh Imam, we have achieved this kind of unity, the second moment Imam comes. As I said to the sisters, you know, Imams said, or to brothers, I don't know, in one of Tawqi's, you know, writings, لو أن أشياعنا وفقهم الله لطاعته على اجتماع من الأمر. If our Shia were together, والوفاء بالعهد, and loyal to the promise, لما تأخر عنهم اليمن بلقائنا. The blessing of meeting us would not be delayed. Why it's delayed? Because there is no ijtima, there is no unity, there is no loyalty. We think just by celebrating for the middle of Sha'ban, things will be sorted out. Okay, this is good, but this is not enough, this is too little. If you want to make Imam Zaman happy, make people close to each other, bring people close to each other, bring mosque, ulama, everyone that you can, bring them together. This is to make Imam Zaman happy. Okay, I cannot go further. My heart is, you know, full of, I don't know, pain or what. So I have to say this thing. But we have to stop. It's very important to see what can now we do. Because always people say, now what should we do? We know that something great is missing. What can we do? So if, inshallah, you don't mind, I think we can divide brothers maybe to three groups, and perhaps sister also three groups, that for half an hour, inshallah, they think about the ways that we can make some, inshallah, progress. And let me tell you also, don't wait for others. Don't say, you know, what is the responsibility of Hose or Maraje or leaders or Imams or whatever. This is not helpful. Just see what me and you can do. Yeah? Instead of thinking what others have to do, let us see what we can do. We people who are here, what can we do? And then inshallah we can set up example for others. So the question is, what are the practical steps that we can take to reach this point of having an Islamic community with all the characteristics, but especially this unity that must exist between us. So, everyone has paper and pen, everything they have?
Inshallah.
So, everyone doesn't have, you know, can ask. So, you know, you can sit comfortable if you want to use chair or sit on the ground, take tea, coffee, everything.
What is the website you said you can get the lecture?
Collective Nature of Wilaya,
yeah.
YouTube, Shia TV, if you put Collective Nature of Wilaya, Stockholm. Because there are several of them. Because whenever I get chance in every part of the world, I say, even if there is a brother in car, I speak about.
So you put your name on the YouTube and then...
I haven't put this, brother in Stockholm. You put Collective Nature of Wilaya, Shomali, it comes. And there is also paper published. If you want in Farsi and English, go to shomali.net, the paper. But the paper is not that much engaging like lecture, yeah. Paper is for those who want to have references and, you know, quotations.
Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
صلى الله عليه
وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين لا سيما بقية الله في الأراضين أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف. So inshallah we are going to listen to the conclusions that you have made, but I just want to say that never underestimate ideas that you or other people may have and say, you know what, we are going to do, we cannot change anything. You have to be always hopeful. If you look at the life of the Prophet ﷺ, you see he started with just few people who were united. They changed the whole world. Imam Ali started with tens of thousands of people who were divided. So he didn't manage to anything. Despite his leadership, he couldn't succeed. Therefore, inshallah, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala finds that we are united and there is sincerity, maybe Allah chooses you as his agent, and through you, inshallah, Allah can do lots of things. You have to get rid of your ego, then Allah will own you, inshallah. So it's absolutely important to take these things seriously, and inshallah, maybe some good ideas come. Example that I never forget. Many years ago, I was with two, you know, alims, and we were discussing, and they were saying that they have big problem with a senior alim. And, you know, for example, there is no organization, they don't keep promise, you know, things like this. And I knew that to some extent they are right. Then at the end they said, you know, they wanted to finish it in a positive way. They said, okay, let's forget him and work for Imam Zaman. And this is the conclusion that normally we make. We say, okay, forget others, I want to do something. So what should I do? I start a new mosque. I start a new center, a new... I told them, for the sake of Imam Zaman, you have to work with him, with all the difficulties. If you have problem with your father or mother, you cannot run away from house. You have to remain within the family and house and try to improve. If our hawza, our ulama, our maraja, I don't know, our local alims, if they have problem, but this is my family, this is my community, I cannot, you know, say, I don't bother anymore, I start something new. So you are increasing the problems. If we love Imam Zaman, we should show this by showing the amount of sacrifice that you are ready to make. How much you are ready to make sacrifice? This is important. How much you are ready to bring people together? I am 100%, you know, aware that I don't have good answers and good solutions for the problems, you know, because I think this is not something that one person can understand. It is only when we come together and think together and work together that Allah gives us the answer. If you expect, you know, someone sits in a room and, you know, gives you 10 pages of, you know, plan that you do this, I don't think it works. When you come together and you say to Allah, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, then you can say, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ. You cannot go to one single person and say, you know, guide me. No, we have to come together and then we say, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ. And definitely Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا.